In the realm of modern workforce dynamics, understanding how employees engage with self-learning, feedback, and professional development is paramount for fostering a thriving workplace culture. Now, each generation have a nuanced approach to work with distinct approaches as to how they approach different aspects of their careers. And in recent times, Gen Z has been accused of needing a little bit more of that constant validation and praise from their employer. And quite interestingly, our latest research does substantiate this claim. So joining me today on the podcast to discuss this, as well as some of the other trends and insights that we've uncovered from our Generations Defined report to investigate all about Gen Z, is a Gen Z himself and our research executive extraordinaire at McCrindle, Joshua Kemp. Josh, welcome to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks, Ash. It's great to be here.
You are making your debut on the podcast, so it might be new to some of our listeners. So excited to introduce you and to hear some of your learnings and your wisdom. As I mentioned, we know that so far you are a part of Gen Z, which means that you are aged between about 14 and 28 years of age, just to not give away your exact age, but to just give the listeners a bit of a ballpark figure. And we also know that Gen Z, your generation, currently comprise 27% of the global workforce, but by 2035, your generation will comprise 31%. So of course, as the younger part of your generation kind of continue to age and leave school, more of you come into the workforce. So an important demographic for business leaders to be thinking about. But Josh, when you think about your generation, yourself, your friends and colleagues who belong to Gen Z, how would you describe some of your generation's defining characteristics?
Yeah, absolutely right, Ash. And I think, yeah, Gen Z is a very important demographic and we like to be thought of that way. So thank you very much. but you're right. There are some pretty unique traits that define us as a generation. And I think the first most obvious trait that everyone's been talking about and that gets, a lot of airtime is definitely how we see the world in this, digital landscape and how this digital technological world has shaped us as Gen Z. So as you said, Gen Z is from 1995 to 2010. So the oldest of us, we were only 8 when MySpace was first launched, if that gives you a bit of an idea of our age. And we were entering our teenage years when the first iPhone came out. So I remember in high school when we transitioned from this central computer lab in the middle of school where everyone would go maybe once or twice a week, and we transitioned from this to trolleys of laptops that could be wheeled into any classroom and incorporated into any lesson, just showing how this digital landscape, I guess, was being incorporated into our lives. So whilst many of Gen Z, my generation, weren't born into this current digital world of social media, like Gen Alpha coming after us, we really have been molded by it as we've grown up, and we don't remember a time before it. Ash, I've got a question for you. Do you remember dial-up? What was your experience of dial-up, Ash?
Yeah, I do. I think in primary school, I remember hearing that sound, da-dung, 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 like that kind of thing. But I was in primary school. So yes, I do remember it. But Josh, do you remember it?
So I was actually having a conversation about this the other week, and the only memory I have of dial-up was when we had moved to a new house and we were waiting on our Wi-Fi to get connected. And there was this whole week of just listening to this annoying sound and not being able to go on the internet at the same time when my parents wanted to use a landline and everything like that. And I literally had to experience it for 1 week, and it was such a struggle. So coming from a Gen Z, I don't know how you millennials did it before us, before technology, but congratulations and good job. I guess that just goes to show how molded we have been by this digital world. And then outside of that, other traits that do come to mind is the global perspective that Gen Z have, likely due to the impact this digital world has had on us, and also our attempts at pursuing authenticity in our lives. So since I was a teenager, it's been completely normal to talk and interact with others across the world. even when I've been studying, I've been able to study with people in other countries. And even when we talk about traveling with our friends, it's no longer, oh, let's go over east, let's go west, let's go somewhere within our own country. It is, oh, okay, let's go travel to Europe, let's go to the US, let's go explore Asia. It's rarely within our own country. It's that global perspective. This social media and internet world that we've grown up in has really connected us with people, events, and cultures throughout the world. But then there is also this other side of social media, which I do know that you've talked about on the podcast in the past, on the podcast before. And that's where we've grown up in this world of social media, where we have our highlight reel, we show everyone how great we are. And Gen Z have grown up in this. As I said, we've been molded by it. And now we're reaching the other side of it. We've had that flip. We've had this, I guess, response to this highlight reel we have in social media, where we are really quick now to detect the inauthenticity of those around us. And I think that is really a significant trait of Gen Z, especially as I look around to my friends and my coworkers who are within my generation. They really are seeking those genuine relationships with those around them.
Yeah, absolutely. There's some great insights there, Josh. Thanks for sharing. And quizzing me on when and if I remember dial up. And yeah, you're right. Older generations had to exhibit a lot more patience, which is also, I think, one of those things like you've just indirectly kind of alluded to, that younger generations get a little bit of that badgering from older generations, like, oh, they're not patient, they don't know how to wait for anything. And you've kind of just explained why that is the case, because you're a generation, and even for me, I would say as a younger millennial, we're just not used to that. Whereas older generations, you know, were formed in those times where they did have to wait and maybe earn that time online, whereas for us, it's just been, you know, instant. So some really fascinating insights, a lot of different angles there. So thank you for sharing that. But I wanted to get your thoughts as well on how I opened this episode and kind of how we've even named the episode around whether Gen Z does actually need more praise. And there's been a lot of commentary, I would say this year, about Gen Z needing more praise, especially in the workforce. And as I alluded to in the introduction, interestingly, we did find this to be true in our research. We found that more than half, so 54% of Gen Z, say they prefer to receive praise in a workplace context at least a couple of times a week, which was more than the other generations. And as generations got older, that percentage kind of declined with the age. So Josh, I'd be keen to hear your reflections as a researcher, but also as someone who is part of this generation. Do you have any insights on this as to whether, you know, why, and if you do agree that this generation, your generation in Gen Z, do want more praise at work?
Yeah, thanks, Ash. On one side, I'm thinking, we're strong, independent Gen Zs. We don't need no praise. We can just get it done. But then there's the other side where I'm like, yes, please give us praise. We need it to survive. And I think since we released this report, I have been using it as a topic of discussion to sort of talk to my friends about it. Hey, what do you think about this? Do you think we need more praise? And one of my friends over the weekend was actually like, I don't think it's we need more praise. I think it's just we need more hype in the workplace. We need people to get around us and just hype us up a bit more. So I think, yeah, Gen Z do need that praise. I just don't think we like saying it. And I think it does really make sense when you think about the world we've grown up in with social media, and as we're getting into this life stage, we're wanting to develop our careers, and even the parenting style that we, I guess, a majority of Gen Zs grew up with. So in regards to social media, we've grown up in a world where platforms like Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok, they're central to the way that we socialize with the people around us. We're scrolling through these social networks, and every like, comment, or share, it's this mini piece of feedback, just instantaneous feedback that we get. Oh, people thought this, people thought that. And it's not only, I guess, the praise, oh my gosh, you're so good, but it's also the constructive criticism that I think Gen Z may be seeking as well. We're living in this digital age where the feedback is instantaneous. So it's no surprise that we desire that same type of praise and type of feedback in our workplaces. And another element of it would be this life stage that we're in. With this career, we're really developing, okay, we're coming out of university, figuring out where we're wanting to take our lives. And I don't think, as I said, it's just about praise and the pat on the back, but it's also important to note that for Gen Z, we are graduating school, we are graduating university and our trades, and we're entering into full-time work for the first time. So whilst, don't get me wrong, we do like praise, but we're also looking for that constructive criticism. The research showed, and we'll get into this a bit later, that we also value learning and personal growth. And I think that is reflective of where we are in life. So whenever we do get that feedback or praise, it's like this mini roadmap, this little compass of, hey, you're doing great here, but here's where you can grow. And as we're trying to figure out what our career looks like, that's going to be so key for us to develop as employees within organizations and future leaders as well. And the third element that I did note at the start is the parenting style that we grew up with. Especially around me, I do notice that the parenting style of my friends, and especially the transition from the millennials to the Gen Z, it really has shifted. It's so much more about now involving your children in the decision-making processes and where suitable, I guess, and also valuing our opinions. So now as adults, we're really seeking that in the workplace. We're not looking for somewhere where you just come, get our work done and go home. And even talking to my parents, when they were starting out in the workplace, they were looking for workplaces where they could, okay, I've gained this knowledge at university. Now let's find a workplace. Let's do our 9 to 5, apply the skills we've learned, go home, and we'll focus on that career development down the line. But for Gen Z, we really want to be involved in those decision-making processes now and be a part of growing our organizations as a whole.
Yeah, wow. Josh, such an informed answer from your own, I guess, journey and life as part of this generation, but then also weaving in the research. I think you've pointed out a couple of really interesting things here because for me, I'm always kind of trying to navigate when people ask me about particular traits or characteristics that a certain generation possesses. I think what people are trying to understand is this reflective of their generation or is it just reflective of their life stage? And I think there's always going to be a tension. There's always going to be elements of both. But I think like you've mentioned, you've got the fact that Gen Z are young and they're starting out in their career, so they need that praise, which is probably the same for every generation. When the boomers were 21 years old in their first job, they were looking for validation, feedback, praise, encouragement, and they were doing well because you've got maybe more insecurity, you don't have that life experience or the wisdom that older generations do have. So that's probably more a life stage thing. But then you also mentioned social media, which older generations didn't have. And I think that's really not obvious. I'm not like, oh, you stated the obvious, but you stated something that's obvious that I just hadn't really thought of before. Like even just the fact that when all of us are on social media and we post something, that instant validation praise comes through and it does have an impact on even like dopamine and kind of that addictive feel good emotion and hormone. And that is shaping a generation in their formative years. So that totally makes sense that they're bringing that with them into the workplace. So thanks very much for sharing that and even, yeah, alluding to things we can blame our parents for. No, I'm joking. but like the impact of parenting styles even definitely on that is quite interesting. So thanks for sharing that. Something else that this research uncovered that we have delved into about each generation as well is their top hopes and fears. And it was, again, quite interesting because different generations had different hopes for their life. And for Gen Z, it was to own their own home, have full financial freedom and independence, travel and see the world, pursue interests and hobbies and free up time and spend it with those I love. Josh, I'd love to hear your reflections on those top hopes. Was there anything surprising to you in that or even in maybe the order of how they came out?
Yeah, Ash, initially I was really surprised, especially at McCrindle. We have a lot of research showing that Gen Z are seeking more out of their jobs. They're not just looking for that standard 9 to 5. They're looking for, yeah, the deeper engagement. And because of this, I didn't expect owning their own home or financial freedom would come out in the top two. I was expecting these to be a bit further down and then having that pursuing the interests and traveling the world being up a bit higher. They still came out at 3 and 4, but I was expecting, I guess, that flip. But I think it's whilst Gen Z love this fast-paced, changing world that we live in, we've also lived through, firstly, some significant financial downturns that have really influenced how we see the world. So the first and most obvious would probably be COVID-19. And Gen Z were significantly impacted by this, especially in Australia, where a lot of my friends were in that retail and hospitality sector where there was those shutdowns. As we did go into lockdown, they weren't able to work and weren't able to get that income. They really felt it. And then from now, as they are, a lot of them are in the rental market, not many of them are in their own homes. So they're really feeling the fluctuating market where we have here in Australia. And then on the flip side of that, we've also experienced it as we grew up, because the GFC in 2008, whilst you were probably an adult and experienced it for yourself, Ash, we were still quite young. So it didn't impact us directly in a financial way, but we saw the way that it impacted our parents and the other people around us and how they dealt with the financial impacts that event had around the globe. So living through these events, it really isn't surprising that Gen Z want this financial anchor through owning our own home, as well as that financial freedom and independence. So I think whilst it did surprise me initially, once I did think about it a bit more and think about our context as Gen Z, it really did not. We really want that anchor to really, if there is another financial or economic downturn, if it does come, we can look after ourselves and our future family, despite whatever the external factors may be. And I think so, traveling and seeing the world and pursuing interests and hobbies, whilst I thought they were going to be at the top, they did come through as 3 and 4. And I think there is that strong thread of freedom and independence through those hopes as well. For many Gen Zs, especially those around me, when we talk about travel, it's not about finding this nice hotel far away and vacationing. But a lot of the people that I talk to, when we talk about travel, we just want to learn. So we've grown up in this global, this digital world where we've seen so many snippets of different cultures on our screens. And now travel is an opportunity to connect the dots within that, to really immerse ourselves in those stories and diverse cultures across the world. Even for myself, if you ask me where I do want to travel, every spot on that list is because of the unique history or culture that location may carry. And thanks to social media, I guess, our identity as Gen Z is not just, oh, I am Australian. Yes, I am Australian. But it's also that global identity, and it's something that we do want to dive into head first. And then the fifth hope that you mentioned, this pursuing interests and hobbies, I think that really comes down to identity. And I think that may be why Gen Z have this hope as their fifth hope. So we value this authenticity and self-expression. We have so much information coming through at all times. I think even for myself, hobbies have been an opportunity for me to authentically figure out what I love and enjoy doing and develop a passion for that. I've had hobbies across squash, games, playing with technology, rock climbing, and regardless of the hobby, they've always given me something to be passionate about. And for my generation, a lot of them have even evolved into that entrepreneurial venture, which we're seeing more and more of with the rise of the side hustle. And I think that feeds into that top hope of financial freedom within our generation.
Yeah, it's great reflections, Josh. I agree with everything. I think, I was kind of surprised to see like own your own home at the top, because just the economic climate is so tough. And I'm kind of, a bit surprised by that. But then we've done other research that kind of shows that great Australian dream is still really alive and well in the next generation. So I kind of thought maybe travel would be above that, because it seems like sometimes, people who are locked out of the housing market are like, well, I can't get into the housing market, but I still want to enjoy my 20s or whatever, so I'll spend it on travel. But I mean, travel's still up there with 59%. But I'd be keen as well, Josh, just to probe you on one of your answers, which was around the pursuing interests and hobbies question, or the hope and fear, because I think I've seen a fair bit of commentary in the media around Gen Z being labeled as the loneliest generation. You mentioned the impact of the pandemic and of course digital devices, and how much more they are spending, how much more time is spent online in online communities. But what are your reflections on that? Do you feel like you've got a friends and family maybe in this generation who maybe aren't tapping into community or hobbies where they can meet other people, as say we've seen in previous generations?
Yeah, definitely. And I think an element of that is that we have so many hobbies and so many online communities where we can grow on our hobbies. So for example, you have craft groups where maybe once upon a time, the baby boomers would go to their local community center, get together and really pursue this hobby together. But now we can go to YouTube, we can go to TikTok, we can learn these skills without having that genuine interaction with those around us. And I think that has had a significant impact. And as you said, we get labeled as the loneliest generation. And it's not because we're not interacting with others, because we are, but it's because we're not interacting with them in person anymore. And that has had an impact on myself. That's had an impact on my friends. And I know even if you don't have those for myself, if I haven't sort of set aside time to hang out with my friends, to spend that quality time together, there's just so much that's happening in our world. It's so fast paced that it can just fall to the wayside and be forgotten about almost.
Yeah, it's definitely, I think, a challenge for all of us in terms of just around, you know, plugging into community and engaging with people in that way. But for, I think, younger generations particularly, and for the Gen Zs, it is something so important that older generations know, but something we can learn from them as well, I think. So really important stuff. So thanks for your insights on that. Something else we explored in the research was Gen Zs are top attractors to work. And it was interesting because these were quite different across the generations. For Gen Y, the number one was flexible working hours. For Gen X, it was remuneration. For the baby boomers, it was convenient location. But for Gen Z, it was accessible and approachable leadership was number one, learning and development opportunities number two, and career progression opportunities number three. Did you feel like when you reflect on these that this is pretty reflective of that life stage that Gen Z are in?
Yeah, definitely. And I think every generation has, as you said, these unique set of priorities. And I think that is, yeah, different generation to generation as we're starting out and entering the workplace, and really is reflective of, one, the life stage we're in, and two, the world that we grew up within. Gen Z are in the center of this crucial stage where we are trying to figure out what our career looks like and what we're looking for in the workplace. And I think the major story that the data shows us is that we're not just looking for personal growth. We're not just looking to be part of something bigger than ourselves. We're not just looking for that job, but we're looking for a mix of all that. There is an element that, yeah, we want it all as Gen Z, but I think it's about finding the balance between that personal growth and being part of something more, and also having that obviously financial income to set ourselves up to be financially free and own our own home one day, as that is still the hope and the dream. And the top attractor to work, accessible and approachable leadership, I think that really reflects the authenticity that we're looking for around us. It's more than just having an open door policy with our bosses and leaders within the workplace. And whilst this is great, we do also want to build those genuine relationships in our professional relationships as well. Going back to the hobbies where we may be, I guess, missing out on those genuine relationships and those genuine connections through that, the workplace has really become something where we can find those genuine connections. We can interact with others. And it's not just, you're somebody that I'll talk to at 9 till 5, but I don't actually like you very much and I'm going home, see you later. But it's like, okay, yes, I'm with you 40 hours a week. Let's build these genuine connections. Let's build these genuine relationships. And we're in this together. So let's do it together. Especially right now our last stage as we're entering the workforce, mentors can be a huge part of that development. And I know for myself and many of the Gen Z friends around me, we're looking for mentors who can guide us, leaders who listen, and an overall environment where our voices are heard. We don't just want that traditional hierarchy. And whilst we recognize that's important, I think what we're looking for is this collaboration and mutual respect within that structure. And then the second and third attractors to work were learning and development opportunities and career progression opportunities. And I think these tell a pretty significant story of the life stages Gen Z are in at the moment. As I said, we've just graduated from uni or just graduating from school, and we're looking for those internships, those graduate programs, or our first full-time job. And I think the second attractor, learning and development opportunities, are so important for Gen Z, because we've grown up being told that the world is constantly accelerating, constantly evolving, constantly changing, and we're going to have to continue to relearn if we want to keep ahead of the game. I think it's, yeah, a stat that we have here at McCrindle that the those entering primary school today, 65% of them will be in roles that don't exist yet. And that is really reflective of, as Gen Z, as we do go through our careers, whilst we won't be entering the career market in 20 years' time, we will still be well and truly within the job market, we'll still be developing. And our hope is that any job we do look for has those learning and development opportunities weaved throughout it. So we don't have to, I guess, go seeking for them elsewhere, but we're already halfway there with having them included in the role. And the third attractor, career progression opportunities. We're in the stage of life, as I said, that we are trying to figure out what our career looks like. We are trying to figure out what this, okay, we finished up school, we may be coming out from underneath our parents' roofs and everything like that. And we're trying to figure out, okay, what does my life look like now? What's my life going to look like in a few years' time? And we're trying to figure out those next steps. We all hear these jokes about Gen Z expecting to be CEOs by 30 years old and wanting to run up the career ladder. But I think it is more than that. I think it's, whilst, yeah, okay, it'd be cool to be at the top. But I think it was you that I, yeah, first heard say that it's no, that this career ladder is no longer a ladder that you just climb up, but it's more of a jungle gym that you swing through and you're working your way around and experiencing it all as you do so. And that really resonates with myself and a lot of Gen Z too. We don't just want roles wherein we just do a 9 to 5, clock in, clock out, go out home. But you want those roles and careers where we can be constantly learning and having an impact, be it in the workplace or the wider world. And to find that, especially in the stage of life where we're learning so much about our careers, but also ourselves, we want to, I guess, swing through that jungle gym, take those career progression opportunities and almost find our place in the world. Like even going back to earlier in our conversation about Gen Z needing more praise than other generations, when we do receive our praise, that praise, it's like this reaffirmation that we're on the right path as we figure out, as we navigate this stage of our life and our careers.
Yeah, it's really, I think, great to see, you know, Gen Z being pretty ambitious with regards to their careers. And in some ways, like I think it's great that they view work as more than just a job, and for that purpose and for that social connection. But then I think the other aspect that we all learn as we get older is, of course, you know, work can't be everything to us. We have to have balance and boundaries and to have relationships outside of work as well. So there's all these like amazing, I think, great positives that come out of these desires for work, but then also just things to be aware of, I think, for this generation. But I think it's great as well to see that Gen Z have high expectations of their leaders as well, and they're looking for leaders who are accessible and approachable. And like you said, Josh, it's very life stage for this generation, I think, to be just like, let's go, like let's career progress, let's swing through the jungle gym, let's try new things. And I was actually talking to someone who's a little bit older about how much or how often younger people have a willingness to change jobs and careers. Now, I'm really bucking that trend because I've been at McCrindle for a long time, and you've got the average tenure of people staying in one job for just under 3 years. And it was really interesting because I was talking to this person, telling them about the stats around this, and he was like, yeah, you know, I've been at my company for decades. And he's like, whereas my daughter, like, she's like, Dad, come on, like, change jobs. She's like, you can negotiate pay, you can sit, learn new things. And it was just interesting for him to reflect on that mindset difference and that shift between older generations who are like, no, I've got to exhibit loyalty here, whereas younger generations are like, it's not me leaving from a lack of loyalty, it's just looking for new opportunities and progressing and having that jungle gym kind of mentality. So it's really interesting to see, I think, the differences in even that internal kind of perspective around what different generations are looking for in a job and how likely they are to even change jobs. So amazing to see that, I think. And again, something where in this case, the father in the situation was like, I've got things to learn from my Gen Z kids around approaching careers and work. So I think it's good when we can value that difference and approach things in different ways. But another really fascinating stat or area that we found in this report was just where people, where different generations are turning to find out not just information and entertainment, but to teach themselves new skills. And it was amazing to see that one in two Gen Z turn to TikTok to teach themselves new skills on a daily basis. Josh, I'd be keen to hear your reflections on TikTok and this stat, and also if you think it's playing into career and workforce expectations as well.
Yeah, I found this stat quite funny because, so my friendship group, we sit in two major categories. We have those on TikTok who love it, who use it daily for both entertainment and to absorb the content in their areas of interest. And then we have the other half who are very proud of the fact that they haven't been drawn into TikTok. But the reality is they're watching the exact same videos just 2 weeks later on an Instagram reel. And there have been so many times where I found myself drawn into this TikTok or Instagram reel, this short form rabbit hole, watching everything from funny fail videos to light bulb reviews to how to bake a new dish. And to be honest, I love it. It's great. Like, I'm learning so much and it's amazing. But coming back to your question, I think TikTok is, yeah, the definition of Gen Z's learning style. It's quick, it's visual, it's super engaging, and we're a generation that's used to getting this information in bite-sized, engaging formats, and TikTok delivers just that. Whether it's a 60-second tutorial on how to edit a photo or a quick hack on public speaking, it's all there and it's perfectly sorted by, I guess, this amazing algorithm that TikTok has, really, to, I guess, put it into a package and give it to us ready to be consumed. And Gen Z, I guess, we no longer want to sit through that two-hour workshop with a video, two-hour workshop where we learn how to do this one thing, where we could just have this concise 2 to 5 minute video where it can just give us a head start, we can get into the work and we can figure out what we're doing. And coming to the second half of your question, where one and two Gen Zs are learning this way, I think it has to play into our career and workforce expectations. The first and probably most obvious way is our appetite for swift learning. We don't want these long structured videos to work through as we're starting out in the workplace. But instead, there's this desire for and almost a need for Gen Z to be able to dive into the career head first and have quick on-the-go learning that they can apply straight away into their role. And this also ties into Gen Z's desire for real-time feedback that we're talking about earlier with the likes and the comments. And just like we can instantly know if a TikTok video is a hit based on the likes and comments, we are also looking for that timely feedback at work. And I think that does reflect of, yeah, what we're expecting in our workplace. This collaborative essence of TikTok where you can duet and other people's videos or hop onto these trending challenges that everyone else is doing, which we love doing here at McCrindle as well. I think it also speaks to why Gen Z are looking for such a collaborative workplace, our collaborative work environment. Not just doing our jobs in isolation, but being part of that larger collaborative community.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you referenced it there, like even our company kind of just for fun, you know, jump on the TikTok trends, and we mainly put them on Instagram actually, but and sometimes they're too far ahead of Instagram, like something's trending on TikTok and then we put it on Instagram. I'm like, why didn't this get as much traction as we thought it was going to? But yeah, you're right. I think it definitely plays into that. And I see it too, even as, you know, a younger millennial where I am also on TikTok and like I'll be watching it, and without me being consciously aware of it, it's obviously rewiring, well, not obviously, but I feel like it is rewiring kind of my expectation about how I consume information, because I'll be somewhere else and I'll be like, oh man, this could have been like a 2 minute video, not a 10 minute video. Or like even then I'm like, oh, 2 minutes, that's a long video, because we're just rewiring it. And we're talking mostly, like you said, about a majority of this generation of young people who are taking that rewiring. So yeah, it's definitely, I think, important for all of us to be aware of, whether you're a leader or a marketer or anyone who's trying to communicate with this generation. It's definitely important characteristic and trait to be thinking about. And that does, I think, play into leaders as well in a workplace who are there to inspire and motivate. And when we investigated what Gen Z want in their leaders, we did see a shift across the generations, and that Gen Z are looking for leaders who are approachable, who demonstrate clear communication, and who have empathy. Josh, do you think that this is characteristic and reflective of the world that's shaped Gen Z?
For sure. when I was first starting out in the professional world, I was doing sales and I was in the sales role. And one of my favorite things about my manager at the time was that she was simply human. There was this instance where I made an error on a project. I lost a bit of money or gave the client a great discount, whichever the way you want to look at it, I guess. And I was stressing out big time. And my manager sat me down and I was like, oh no, okay, here we go. But instead of getting in trouble, we actually had the opportunity to discuss the mistake, work through each element of it, and really gave me the opportunity of, okay, what can I learn from this? Where did I go wrong? Okay, what am I going to change next time? And I think that moment was amazing because I was able to be real with my boss, but I was also able to learn more about my role and become a better employee for it. And that moment of empathy and clear communication really meant the world for me, especially in that last stage as I was trying to figure out this professional world. And Gen Z as a whole, we've grown up in this world that is so interconnected, yet so polarized, as we did discuss around the hobbies and everything like that. We value the authenticity and transparency because we know what happens when they're not present in the world around us. This approachability, clear communication and empathy, they all paint a picture of leaders who aren't just those authoritative figures who are up in their office telling us what to do, but they're genuine, real people who are there to offer us support and guidance. And I think for Gen Z, that approachability, it really does translate to accessibility, emphasizing leaders who are relatable and present. Growing up in this digital age where there is so much misinformation, it's really not surprising that clear communication is also valued. And when we seek, I guess, we want workplaces where we can seek that clarity, we can seek that direction, and we can seek that honesty from our leaders. And the third element that you did mention, this empathy, is I'd say almost the most important of the three, because Gen Z are everywhere. They're being drawn to and leaning towards those leaders who do view their team members, not just employees, but as individuals, complete with our own fun emotions, aspirations, and challenges. And I think the empathy, being able to relate, definitely comes into that on a major level.
Yeah, absolutely. Some really great insights there, Josh, and also some advice, and kind of leads me to my last question, just around looking to the future of work for Gen Z, beyond what you just shared there, which was some great advice. Do you have any other pieces of advice for leaders or someone who is listening to this podcast who might be engaging with Gen Z or looking to motivate them, particularly in a workplace, around how they can go about that when they are seeking to inspire, motivate, lead, and communicate with Gen Z?
Yeah, for sure. And I think the next few years are going to be super significant. As you said at the start, more of Gen Z are going to join the workforce, and leaders really have an exciting opportunity to put things in place now that are really going to enable their Gen Z employees to thrive into the future. And the first thing is, I would have to say, in this quickly changing world, leaders really need to be able to listen and adapt. That Gen Z, they thrive on this open dialogue, and we really appreciate it when our voices are heard and considered. We're not really just looking for that job anymore. We're looking for that purpose, that growth, and that sense of belonging. And I'm not just saying that leaders need to adjust to the needs of Gen Z, but to get the best out of us, there is this partnership that is needed through the check-ins, through constructive feedback, and open communication. And the second piece of advice really leans into this, and it's about actively fostering the collaborative environment within a team. Gen Z, we value these diverse perspectives and the sense of community that come with teamwork. And so to get the best out of us, leaders should really foster a space where these collaborative projects and brainstorming sessions are the norm. They are encouraged. And even those people make jokes about having to go on retreats and do those team building activities with their team and everything like that. But I think Gen Z, they're really searching for that. They're really looking to strengthen those bonds within their team that, also boost productivity, which is great for leaders, obviously. The last piece of advice I would have there is to champion the innovation and continuous learning. If half of Gen Z are turning to platforms like TikTok to learn new skills, then we must be looking for that engaging, short-term and relevant learning. And if leaders can offer those opportunities for professional development, workshop and courses that align with this learning style, then they'll really be able to get the best out of this next generation and foster this culture of development and innovation to propel their organization forward into the future.
Awesome insights, Josh. So practical and evidence-based, of course, through the research, but also from your own experience so far in the workforce. So really appreciate your time today. Thanks so much for your Gen Z insights and for coming on the Future Report podcast.
Thanks so much for having me, Ash. Really appreciate
I'm sure everyone can see why we got you on today. Some fabulous insights. And a lot of what you and I have both referenced today is from our latest Generations Define report. So if you'd like to get a hold of that or find out some more information about it, you can head to our website and head to the resources section. And of course, if you'd like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. Follow us on social media for some of those reels that Josh mentioned, or just head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.